Good evening, everyone. I would like to call the Justice and Public Safety meeting to order and have Mr. Mulay give the invocation and Mr. Fish lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance to the flag of the United States of America. All rise, please.
If you will please bow your heads. Heavenly Father, we come to you at the beginning of this month and at the beginning of this budget process. We ask you to please help us, guide us, lead us to do the right thing for the betterment of the county, to make county government more efficient, more effective for the people that all of us work for. Heavenly Father, we also thank you for the presence of one of ours in uniform here tonight, Kimber Gist. We thank you, Lord, for keeping her safe, for blessing her and keeping her continuing to get better and better daily. We thank you, Lord, for her service, for the service of all of our men in uniform, and we ask you to please protect them as they protect us. We ask this in your most holy and precious name. Amen.
Amen. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
First on the agenda is the approval of minutes from the Justice and Public Safety Committee meeting held on March 14, 2016 and on April 11, 2016. I have a motion.
Second.
Are there any corrections to these minutes? Hearing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? The minutes stand approved as presented. I have a proclamation designating May 15, 2016 as Peace Officers Memorial Day in Berkeley County.
Move for approval.
Second.
We are blue tonight. Outstanding. Proclamation designating May 15, 2016 as Peace Officers Memorial Day in Berkeley County. Whereas Congress and the President of the United States have designated May 15th as National Peace Officers Memorial Day, and whereas the members of Berkeley County Sheriff's Office playing an essential role in safeguarding the rights and freedoms of the citizens of our community, and whereas it is important that all citizens know and understand the duties, responsibilities, hazards, and sacrifices of their law enforcement officers, and that law enforcement officers recognize their duties to serve the people of Berkeley County by protecting them against violence and disorder. And whereas the law enforcement officers of Berkeley County Sheriff's Office unceasingly provide a vital public service, now therefore be it resolved that Berkeley County Council hereby proclaims the day of May 15th, 2016 to be Peace Officers Memorial Day in Berkeley County. Now therefore be it further resolved that William W. Pugler, Berkeley County Supervisor, directs that all flags on Berkeley County buildings be flown at half staff on May 15, 2016 to recognize Peace Officers Memorial Day, to memorialize those law enforcement officers who through their courageous deeds have made the ultimate sacrifice and service to their communities and have become disabled in the performance of duty, and to honor those law enforcement officers presently serving our communities. Approve this ninth day of May 2016. Berkeley County Council, William W. Pugler, Supervisor. Sheriff Lewis, you have anything to say?
I'm going to talk just for a second. As we go through what we've gone through this past year, I don't think I have to remind anybody of what our deputies face on a daily and nightly basis. We do acknowledge the officers that have gone on before us, who put their lives on the line and paid that ultimate sacrifice. But I wanted to take just a minute to recognize a couple of folks among us that have given that sacrifice, and by the grace of God, they're here with us. And we have faced a lot of challenges this year. Most of you know that Will Rogers was shot, and he's still in recovery phases. He has retired from the sheriff's office as a captain. We keep in contact with him regularly, and we continue to pray for his success and healing. With us tonight, I'm so proud and happy to have Corporal Kimber Gisk with us. Most of you know the story, and I got to tell you, we are blessed, and she is blessed, to survive an attack like she did at close range with multiple shots, receiving multiple bullet wounds, and able to stand here tonight with us is truly a miracle. So I just want us to please think about our men and women who are out there. They have a dangerous, dangerous job, but it's one that they sign up for. It's one that they raise their right hand and take an oath to protect and serve the people of this great county. And I want to thank each and every one of the council members, Mr. Gunn, for offering this proclamation. And I really do appreciate it. And I'd like for a second to tell you about Kimber. She is still recovering. She is not back to work, although she's been at the sheriff's office some, helping us with some filing and different things when she can prop that leg up. But she is on the road to recovery, and we're so thankful, and we really can't wait. We stand there with our arms open, waiting for you to come back. And so again, thank y'all for recognizing the law enforcement officers tonight. Thank you.
Yoo-hoo now. Coming up to you.
Yeah, the sheriff's laughing at me about my yoo-hoo.
I would like to call the Land Use Committee to order. Ms. Clark, has this meeting been properly noticed via the Freedom of Information Act?
Yes, sir, it has.
Thank you. First on the agenda is approval of the minutes from the Land Use Committee meeting held on April 11, 2016.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Are there any corrections to these minutes? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposes, nay. Minutes stand approved as presented. Next is consideration prior to first reading, and this is the ordinance to modify the official zoning and development standard map of Berkeley County, South Carolina, in regards to Jensen Lane Properties, LLC, for TMS 267-00-00-092 and 267-00-00-076. This is 2.01 total acres located at 454 Jensen Lane, Charleston, South Carolina. This is in the Wando area, and they want to rezone from heavy industrial to general commercial. This is in County Council District 8. Ms. Simmons.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The applicant is requesting to rezone the subject parcel in order to establish conformance with the rest of the Jensen Lane Industrial Park and allow better use of the subject property. The request is consistent with the future land use designation of employment. Staff found the request consistent with the character of the area and recommended approval. Also, Planning Commission recommended approval in a unanimous vote.
Move approval.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Is there any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries. Okay, item two has been withdrawn. We're going to item three, and this is an ordinance to modify the Lazy Hill Plan Development Mixed Use PDMU guidelines in regard to RGW LLC for TMS 196-00-00-090, and this is also TMS 196-00-00-103 and TMS 196-00-00-104, and this is 30 acres located at 2542 South Live Oak Drive, Cypress Ridge Development in Monk's Corner in County Council District 6. Ms. Simmons.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The applicant is requesting to amend the Lazy Hill PDMU in order to eliminate the allotment for 30 acres presently allocated for general commercial use in order to replace it in its entirety with an allotment for 30 acres of multifamily use, including three-story apartments or attached single-family townhomes, at a maximum density of 18 dwelling units per acre. The current Lazy Hill PDMU supports 117 acres for single family residential uses, 206 lots at a maximum density of 1.76 dwelling units per acre, 22.5 acres of multifamily townhomes at a maximum density of 11 dwelling units per acre and 180 dwelling units, and 30 acres of general commercial use. The applicant is requesting to accommodate upwards of 324 additional dwelling units. Currently, there are 386 dwelling units supported in the Lazy Hill PDMU. Staff did not find the request consistent with the comprehensive plan designation of low density suburban supporting single family residential detached housing, open space, civic and recreation, and mixed uses where appropriate. Some objectives of the low-density suburban designation include the development of diverse housing choices in neighborhoods that promote a sense of community, providing an aesthetically pleasing transition from constrained growth areas to higher density residential and commercial areas, and that new developments will provide for a mix of land uses and project designs to ensure the long-term sustainability or economic and environmental health of both the individual and broader community in which it is located. Staff's primary concern with this request is that it does not comply with the standards established in Section 8.2.3 Mixed Use Development, P PDMUs, particularly subsection E, that the maximum density allowed in PDMUs should be 3 dwelling units per acre. With the increase in multifamily residential housing at a maximum density of 18 dwelling units per acre, the overall density may increase to up to 5.2 dwelling units per acre, exceeding the 3 dwelling units per acre threshold. The current residential development of the PDMU is 2.9 dwelling units per acre. Secondly, staff did not find the request to be consistent with subsection D of the PDMU requirements, and that PDMUs should include a mix of residential and commercial uses, specifically, explicating that multifamily is not included as a commercial use for purposes of this article. By eliminating the area reserved for commercial and retail uses, staff finds the request to diminish the intent of PDMU zoning, which is to provide compatible and accessible employee retail and commercial uses for its residents. Staff understands that a big box grocery store, as contemplated in the original Lazy Hill PD, may not be supported on site. However, staff finds that small scale neighborhood commercial or even office uses may be supported, particularly with an increase in overall dwelling units. Lastly, the PDMU requirements do not establish a percentage threshold for commercial or non-residential uses, allowing the developer the flexibility to accommodate the percentage of commercial uses that can be reasonably supported in the development based on its unique demographic and market conditions. Staff made a recommendation of denial. Planning Commission made a recommendation for approval and a vote of 3-1 with one member recusing himself.
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Whitley.
Ms. Simmons. Who is the one who dissented and the commissioner who dissented and who is the commissioner that recused themselves?
The one that dissented was Ms. Lynn Hoover. She had specific reasoning for that, particularly some of the other standards established or proposed for the PD, which have since been resolved. The one that recused himself was Mr. Jake Serrano.
Okay. And in terms of your very thorough presentation, this is just adding a lot of folks on this land right on 17A, and it's going to be right on 17A, right?
That's correct.
The buffer's what?
The buffer is proposed to be 37.5 along 17A for the townhome development, which is consistent with the buffering that presently exists for the townhome land use allocation, and 50 feet along 17A with a berm for the multifamily component.
Okay.
Mr. Chairman.
Thank you.
Mr. Cheryl Knight.
Is there a representative of the developer here tonight?
Mm-hmm. Yes, sir.
Or they could be able to speak.
Sure.
Would a representative come up and give you 4 minutes? That might not be very much, but it'll be 4 minutes.
I can do it in 4 minutes or less. I'm Eric Greenway, representing the property owner Butler Ware on this action here this evening. Mr. Ware, my address is 760 Rabin Run, Ridgeville, South Carolina.
Might I close this up?
Mr. Ware rezoned this property back in 2005 for the purpose of putting a commercial development on the property. So that was 11 years ago. We think that there's some special situations here about this property. This is a commercial strip center that's right across the street from the property where we are going, that we're discussing this evening. And as you can see, the property is vacant. So there's no retail or office market in this area, and hasn't been for 11 years. This is a 1 acre parcel also across the street from the property that's for sale and has been for sale for some times. This is the use on the adjacent corner from the property. We have an RV, a metal carport, and a guy selling potted plants from the property there. So Mr. Butler Ware hasn't been able to develop his property in 11 years for commercial users. He can't find anyone that wants to be there for a commercial user. He has the property under contract with the townhome developer to extend their project across the street to the other side of the road. This is another commercial property in the area that's sitting vacant. And then, of course, this is the Charleston Auto Auction here. This is the buffer yard on the other side of the entrance, as you currently see here, where they are developing townhomes right now. You can see dirt piled up in that area along 17A right there.
Is that adjacent?
That's on the other side of the main entrance, where the other townhomes are currently being constructed at this point.
You're talking about the other side of Lazy Hill Road or the other side of 17A?
Other side of Cypress, of the entrance into this subdivision that got rezoned that she had talked about, had the 300 and something units in it. I don't have a good map of that to show you.
I think that's Cypress Ridge Road.
It's Cypress Ridge Road or Cypress One. Or it's not Cypress Point. It's Cypress Ridge Road. It's going into the entrance of the single family subdivision. So my point is that Mr. Ware has marketed this property for 11 years. There's been no commercial market there. There's not a commercial market there. You can see all the vacant commercial properties in the area. I do realize that we don't meet the minimum requirements from the zoning code as far as a commercial mixed-use component on this particular 30 acres, but I think that's more in line with keeping of you don't have someone come in wanting to do a PDMU without providing an opportunity for there to be some commercial uses in an area. And there's plenty of opportunities around this property for commercial users along 17A. You got commercial property, four or five retail units sitting across the street that's vacant, that hasn't been used. Used to be a German restaurant in there. He stayed in business probably 6 or 8 months, went out. Then there was a NFL paraphernalia store that went in there, and that was short-lived as well. So there's just no commercial market here. Mr. Ware has the property under contract, as I said, for someone to extend the townhome project to the other side of the entrance, and for the other half of the property between the townhome project and Lazy Hill Road across the street from where the RV and carport was sitting, for them to do apartments on the remaining portion of the property. So that's all I have, unless you all have any questions for me.
I have a question, Mr. Chairman.
Ms. Whitley.
Is there a less dense option he can use than the maximum density of 18?
Well, now let me clarify a couple of things, because I don't think the presentation was clear on that. We're not proposing any changes to the townhome density. We're only proposing changes to the apartment density on this property. And in order for an apartment complex to be viable with the acres that they're having, for it to be healthy long-term and sustainable long-term, they need between 15 and 18 units to the acre.
But even if it wasn't apartments, is there a less dense option? Say commercial doesn't work.
Right.
You're saying there's not a less dense option?
I don't
density
see
density impactful option.
Well, yeah, I mean, the townhome property could, you know, the townhome project could extend the entire length of the 30 acres eventually, but that's many years down the road.
But in terms of, if this is a, Eric, you've had more practice than most, so fight back with me. But to me, this agreement is among adjacent homeowners down Lazy Hill Road. It's the whole planned agreement, mm-hmm, where they have nice acreage. I mean, it's not a where I live and we all live on, mm-hmm, top of each other, but we knew that going into the plan.
Right.
It's we are moving here to this area, mm-hmm, to have nice acreage,
mm-hmm,
not to be on top of each other, not to have a lot of traffic. Mm-hmm. And you're going to throw in how many apartments?
About 300 units.
300 units
on the apartment.
So I'm worried about the other people in the agreement, in the planned development agreement,
mm-hmm,
that said, okay, I'm going to buy into this place. We're going to have mixed use. We're going to have commercial. We're going to have retail. We're going to have large acreages, right, for, I'm guessing the houses are 2, 3, 5 acres back there. I don't know.
No, they're not that many. You're talking about Lazy Hill?
Yeah,
down Lazy
on
Hill
back
Road?
Down there.
Yeah, I mean, Lazy Hill is a rural area back there where they had larger lots in that area, but the Cypress subdivision here does not have that kind of lot size, where this is adjacent, where you already have the townhomes. So, and there's going to be no, we're going to have Lazy Hill Road buffered appropriately and all
with the
for
berm?
That. Do what?
With the berm?
We haven't proposed a berm down Lazy Hill, but if you guys certainly want us to do that, we'll put a berm in there. There's no vegetation along Lazy Hill Road now for the property, so we can do whatever you guys desire us to do for the buffer along Lazy Hill Road.
All right, thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Gunn.
I'm familiar with the location of this. This is Mr. Shurlnight's district. I'd like his comments on this.
Thank you, Mr. Gunn. First thing, I'll have to agree what Eric was talking about with the commercial accounts or commercial property that's existing out there. I travel this road every day. And there are a lot available, a lot of commercial that comes and goes. It just doesn't last. The four laning of 17 will more than accommodate the traffic that we're talking about on here. Lazy Hill, I don't see a lot of effect this is going to have on Lazy Hill, because Lazy Hill is a good ways behind it, in the back there. These people will be accessing 17 and running the four laning of 17. And all the property on four laning of 17 is subject to some type of development on that. I'll have to agree with the Planning Commission on this one. And I'd like to make a recommendation that we approve it and move it on to the second reading.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes, sir, Mr. Gunn. Mr. Newell.
I won't look anything like you.
No joke. Talking about the commercial, didn't we just build a Family Dollar down the street about a mile, and we also have Berkeley Marine about a mile down the road and a gas station, and mm-hmm. So the commercial is gaining momentum coming from 176 up towards Mount's Corner.
Yeah, and again, I think Family Dollar that you see there, there's never going to be a large big box as it was originally contemplated on this property, because you know, less than 11 minutes away, going toward 52 on the property here, you got a planned commercial area at Fox Bank, and I think that's an appropriate location to have a planned commercial area. 11 minutes in the other direction up Highway 176, you've got the market at King Bay.
What I'm saying is that. I don't like to hear the argument there's no commercial use when you take a strip mall that used to be a hot dog joint at one time, and they had great hot dogs. Because there's, before you get to the Berkeley Marine on the right, you have a little strip area there that those folks have been there for quite some time. Mm-hmm. Strip mall area. Mm-hmm. And then you have, Charleston Auction, you have the gas station, you have other things that are building up there. So I don't like hearing an excuse such as the commercial viability of the property is not there.
Well, the commercial viability of this property is obviously not there, because it's been sitting there for 11 years and no one's looking at it under the current plan for the property, with it being a PDMU. So, I wasn't implying that there's no commercial opportunity in the area. What I was saying is that the commercial opportunity for this property, with given the vacant commercial properties around the area, no one's going to look at this property until those things redevelop and become a higher end user, and that'll take some time. Okay. And it's a fairness issue for me. How long are we going to require someone to hold their property before they can use it and get a reasonable return on it? So,
and Mr. Dewey, there's still a number of commercial sites that's up for sale now, and has been up for sale for a while out there.
And with this apartment complex, talked to the assessor this evening with the number of units proposing, that's a $30 to $50 million investment in Berkeley County right there. And apartments generate less traffic than single family residential, which might could go on this property, but I doubt it with the three frontages and with the travel capacity of Highway 17A. I doubt that you'd see anyone wanting to put single family on this property, as narrow as it is. This is a great multifamily site. And it can be done and be nice. The rental market for this area the apartments are going to start out at 1,000 and go up to 1,250 per month for rent. So that's a pretty good rental income for apartments. And that's all I have.
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Steve Davis.
I've tried to be consistent on county council in reference to these property issues. I'm always concerned anytime there's a split. And Eric, you used to be in the hot seat making these recommendations.
Yes,
first of all, staff recommendation is proper.
Are you asking me?
Yes.
The staff recommendation is proper, but I would submit to you that the property as it sits right now is probably not in compliance with the zoning that's on the property now. It's probably not in compliance with the comp plan either on that issue. So we would be bringing it more toward conformity by converting the property into residential.
And what would be your rationale to say that is not in conformity with the comprehensive plan?
Because the property right now allows for commercial development there. They could do a big, large retail establishment on the property. Now, I don't know that. I haven't reviewed the comp plan in detail. You're asking me a question, but based on the presentation, if it calls for low-density suburban development there, that doesn't generally talk about...
Yeah, it calls for three units, something here. I saw about
three
per acre.
Yeah, I think that's in the PDMU standard.
Yeah. And the whole reason for having these mixed-use development is to try to sustain, for the long run, a viable community out there, right?
Yeah, I don't disagree with that. And again, what I'm saying, Mr. Davis, is that we have already established mixed use in this area with all the commercial zonings that's around this particular piece of property. It's just not, it hasn't happened on this property yet because of all the other commercial users around on 17A. And I don't think it's going to happen because of all the things that we have planned and the other developments that are going on right now. You've got a Harris Teeter plan down at Carnes Crossroad, which is about 6 or 7 minutes away. It hasn't been developed yet. There's a reason why it hasn't been developed yet. And that's because the numbers aren't there because there's not enough people to support that at this point.
But it seemed to me you'd be putting the horse before the cart, because if you're going to put all these apartments and then you will have a need later on to have spaces available to accommodate the folks, then really you've defeated the whole purpose behind mixed-use development that we're trying to establish with the comprehensive plan.
Well, I think Ms. Simmons, alluded to that in her presentation, in that, additional residential users in the area and a little more density may drive commercial development in this area a little more quickly. So that's what the developer and the owner of the property is trying to take advantage of at this point. He's trying to create an opportunity for some of those commercial properties to be redeveloped along 17A to make it better, for that strip center to be used and things like that that's right across the street.
But this particular piece of property is very viable, though, to the comprehensive plan in reference to what we're trying to accomplish.
Yeah, I mean, I agree that the comprehensive plan, based on what it calls for this area, is what Ms. Simmons says it calls for. But there's also some times when you depart from the comprehensive plan, and one of those is to recognize changing conditions in a given area. And we've got a 4-lane road, a 5-lane road out in front of the property. We've got plenty of access along the three frontages here. There's no safety issues. You've got infrastructure in place to handle this type of development. So the comprehensive plan deals with things, and the land use plan map deals with things in a general dynamic, in a general way. Specific properties may require over time that you depart from that or consider a different development option for that property. Comprehensive planning, as I've told you all through my career, is a dynamic process, and it has to recognize changing conditions.
Okay, thank you.
And, this property has sat here for 11 years without any commercial potential, it looks like. So the property owner is asking for this change to take advantage of an opportunity that he has with putting a different use on the property.
Okay.
And we addressed all of the planning commissioner's concerns that voted against the voted against the recommendation of approval. We addressed that after that meeting.
Okay, thank you.
Well, Mr. Chairman, Ms. Whitley, what was Commissioner Hoover's concern?
Ms. Hoover said we were the original request that the property owner and the folks that had the property under contract put for us was just requesting too much relief at that time. So we went back, and they were requesting reduced buffers, more impervious surface, additional building heights, all of those things. So after that, we went back, and there was one a group of folks that spoke, a husband and wife that owns property across the street from this site, that spoke against the property at the Planning Commission meeting. We went back after hearing those concerns and adjusted the plan to be more in line, to make it more compatible with the concerns that were raised at the Planning Commission meeting.
Mr. Chairman?
Mr. Gunn?
What's the height of the apartment complex?
40 feet.
40 feet.
That's in compliance with the base zoning ordinance.
It's three stories.
Do what?
Three
yeah,
stories?
Yes, it's three. Feet? It'll okay. be three stories, but they can get the 40 feet to the eave. It's measured to the eave.
Have you communicated with any of the rural fire departments?
Do what? Well, that's the building height requirement in, okay. in the zoning code. It's 40 feet.
All right. Thank you.
Now, have we gone above that, and originally they wanted to go to 50 feet, but we backed up on that and changed it back to 40.
Thank you.
Any more questions? Call for the vote.
Who's second
on the first.
You did the motion?
Yeah, I did the motion. Okay. I never did the second.
Ms. Cheryl Knight had the motion. And he voted all in favor. Do we have a second?
Second.
Have a second. Mr. Fish. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
All in opposed?
Nay.
We have two nays and three ayes. It'll go for a second reading.
Well, you didn't call. I didn't say anything.
Okay, you didn't? Well, if you don't say my name.
That means you go for the prevailing.
Jack,
side.
I'm going to let it go for second reading. I want some more information on it, okay?
Roll call vote, please.
Yeah. All right.
So I vote in favor for second reading.
We have a.
But I'm not convinced.
Correct.
Four
to two. Okay. So it'll go forward to second reading. All right. Next on the agenda is item two. No, I'm sorry. This is review prior to second reading, bill number 16-05, and this is an ordinance to abandon the sewer easement across TMS.
Approval.
Second.
At this time, we would like to ask John Williams to come forward, and he's going to give a little speech on this.
Speech.
Yep.
Political season enough. We've heard enough speech this year.
I assure you, Mr. Thank Chairman you. And Council, it will be brief. I'm just recommending defeat on Bill 1605. The information that we've requested, we either haven't received or they've stopped communicating with us. So
wow.
until the adjoining owner is interested in acquiring the property, I'm going to recommend defeat, and we can bring it back at another time if they decide that they want the property in a future date.
Mr. Chairman, I will withdraw my motion to approve and
I withdraw my second.
Okay, I have a motion to withdraw and a second to withdraw. I'll ask for a...
Move to deny.
Yep.
Second.
I have a motion to deny and a second. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? The motion's denied. Number two is bill number 16-06. And this is the ordinance to convey TMS number 233-05-04-033 to the adjoining landowner.
What district is it in?
This property's in Sangaree.
Okay.
It's right near Buckskin Lane.
Is that the one with the easement between them? And
yeah. That's right. I believe there's four property owners that adjoin this strip.
Move for approval.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Are there any discussion? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposes, nay. Motion carries. Number three is bill number 16-15, and this is in regards to Nabila Bin Nawa for TMS 233-13-00-036.51 acres, and is 110 Frankie Lane in Ladson. I'm going to go from R2 residential, rural and neighborhood commercial. I'm going to go from manufactured residential to rural and neighborhood commercial. This is in County Council District 4.
Move for denial.
I have a motion to deny.
Second.
I have a second to deny. Is there any discussion?
Mr. Chairman.
Yes, sir.
Question for Councilman Newell. I think the Planning Commission approved it and staff, but you've heard from residents on this one.
I've had about 6 pages full of signatures of folks that live on Frankie Lane.
I'll defer to you.
Thanks, sir.
Okay. Any more discussion? I have a motion to deny and a second. All in favor of denial?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. All opposed? Motion is denied. Number four is bill number 16-16.
Move approval.
Second. Second.
I have a motion and a second. Is there any discussion? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, nay. Motion carries. Number five is bill number 16-17, and this is in regards to Russell S. and Michelle Smith for TMS 224-00-01.
Move approval.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Is there any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries. Next is review prior to third reading, bill number 16-10. And this is in regards to Wayne Cole.
Move for approval.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Is there any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries. Number two is bill number 16-13.
Move for approval.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Is there any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries.
Move to adjourn.
Second.
All in favor, please say aye.
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 All opposed? We are adjourned.
Okay. First on the agenda is the approval of minutes from the Human Resources and
Purchasing
Committee meeting held on April 11th, 2016. I have a motion. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Mr. Davis. Motion and a second. Are there any corrections to these minutes? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, nay. The minutes stand approved as presented. On the agenda tonight, number one, solid waste collection in the Sangaree Special Tax District. Mr. Maxey.
Thank you, sir. We'd like to present the results of best value bid 47018-01-2016-2017 for solid waste collection in the Sangaree Special Tax District. This bid was broken up into four separate lots based on service. We had three participants in the bid, and I'll present the results of each one. For lot A, which is residential commercial garbage cart service, we recommend to award Republic Services with a low bid of $247,909.20. For lot B, commercial front load container service, we'd like to recommend Waste Pro at $52,135.44. For lot C, industrial roll off container service, again, that is Waste Pro, and that is $68,335.80. And then for lot D, residential commercial recycling, we wanted to recommend Carolina Waste at $23,760.
Pleasure of the committee.
Move for approval.
Second.
Mr. Newell.
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Newell.
Tell me how the Republic Services charged us so much more for our county pickup and cut such a big discount for Sangaree. You have any idea?
He did say, Mr. Chairman, but we can defer to somebody from
okay.
Doug's here too. I see Doug. Doug, you might want to come up. Doug, the question is, why is this such a good deal for Sangaree Special Task District when countywide, by the same provider, it's much higher? Is that right, Mr. Newell?
That's right.
Well, I mean, I can't speak to the agreement that was made before. If you will recall, what we just did with Republic was an extension under the contract for 1 year.
Well, wasn't that contract negotiated? Or was it just go ahead and do what you got to do for a year?
It was negotiated.
I can tell you from when I was on council that I remember this bid specifically coming in, and it was a very aggressively bid between three providers. And one of them was Waste Pro, another was Republic, and the other was, they're not in business, they just got bought out.
Carolina
Waste. All three parties were involved. So it's kind of interesting. You can even say to the second place guy, why did you bid so high 2 years ago or 4 years ago, whenever it was? But I tell you, in fact, it was very competitive at the time.
When is that contract up?
Well,
that's August.
Up once we do the extension. Once we finish the extension, and I think what we were trying to do is get past the deadlines that we had. We just couldn't get somebody in place in time to get their equipment in place in the timeline that we had, and also with the issue that we have with recycling, it just became more sense just to extend it for a year and then redo the entire package at that time.
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Supervisor.
Would it be not, you know, because Sangaree is so densely populated that they would not have to travel as far to gather the waste? I mean, is that not a consideration in the bidding of that contract?
Sure, they would absolutely take that into consideration. They've got that one area to serve, and they're limited on their travel and fuel expense. So.
Why didn't they do it last year? That's what I'm saying. This is a farce. I mean, well, I can't say nothing else. I might be illegal. I'll keep my mouth shut.
Councilmember Newell, it wasn't up for renewal last year.
It was an extension last year. Correct. It was an extension. Right.
Most of our bid projects are five-year contracts, but that was before my tenure, and I understand, so I can't answer it.
Yes, ma'am.
This is the end of the complete five-year contract, so it has been completely rebid. It is a small area that they will work in Sangaree, so that's the only thing I'm assuming on their pricing. I mean.
Oh, I understand. I'm not messing with you. Trust me. I'd
rather
fight a tiger.
He's smarter than that.
He ain't stupid. That's what I'm telling him what to do.
Anything else, Mr. Newell? Anybody else? I have a motion and second for approval of Republic, the recommendation of staff. All those in favor signify with aye.
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 Opposed?
Nay.
One nay. Next on the agenda is Airport Fixed Base Operator Aircraft Maintenance Service, Ms. Davis and Ms. Thomas. And I have lots of questions, so I'll go ahead and warn everyone. But first, tell me what this is exactly. All I have is the title. So tell me exactly what this contract does, Ms. Thomas.
Good evening, Council.
Good evening.
This is to have maintenance on the field, and they rent the facility that we have available there to provide aircraft maintenance.
So Light Aircraft of Charleston, and they were the only bidder, correct?
Correct.
So they do what now? They provide the maintenance of what?
Aircraft. He's an aircraft mechanic.
Okay, and so we have a monthly contract with an aircraft mechanic that we keep on site.
He rents a facility from us monthly and provides maintenance service. He is his own business.
He rents from us for $500 a month.
That is correct.
Okay. Ms. Thomas, a couple of questions about, and it may be, if you don't feel prepared for this, it may or may not affect this contract. We can come back and put it on Chairman Pinckney's agenda over the airport. But with the airport being a customer, do you agree the airport's a customer service entity for the county?
Yes, sir.
All right. Why would we not provide a keypad for our customers to get into the airport at night when no one's there after hours?
We have an after hours access fob available to based customers.
How about non-based customers? A pilot comes in, his wife needs to use the restroom. Why would we not allow them access? Doesn't every airport of similar situation have keypads?
Not to my knowledge, no, sir.
Would you look into that for me?
I absolutely will.
All right. Also, what's your policy on allowing the pilot's lounge for pilots? Do we keep that locked more than unlocked?
It's unlocked during business hours, sir.
How about after business hours? What about the tired pilot whose plane, I understand there's a pilot recently who had mechanical problems, worked through the evening, wanted to catch a couple hours of sleep before he could get on, and our pilot's lounge was locked. Why do we ever keep it locked, is my question.
Well, we've had some bad experiences in the past. If he has access after hours, he's absolutely, he can access the entire lobby, as well as the restroom and flight planning.
And the lounge?
But not the lounge.
So only based folks could access it all?
After hours.
After hours?
Yes, sir.
Okay. And?
And for the record, my number is on the door. And if there's a major, if there's an issue, they can call me.
Okay. All right. How about expansion of hangars? You know, are there any plans to get more hangars?
Yes, sir.
What's the status there?
I'll have to defer that. I mean, there's a group that's readdressing. They had council's approval number of years ago to lease property and to build additional T hangars.
A private company to do that?
Well, it was an LLC. It was a group mostly of based pilots who had gotten together, formed an LLC, and were preparing to do so when the economy crashed.
Okay.
Price of units went from $41,000 to $62,000, and they bailed. Now they're re-looking at trying again, from my understanding.
All right, and who sets our fuel prices?
We do. It's based on what we pay for it.
We as in you?
Well, yes, sir.
Okay. And I understand it's higher than other surrounding airports. Is that your understanding?
No, sir. We beat the pants off of everybody around us.
You beat the pants off of everybody in fuel?
Not everyone, but for the most part.
All right. Well, I'm a state district, a county councilman, Ms. Thomas, and you can take it for however it's worth. I'm getting some complaints on the customer service end of the airport, and quite frankly, I hope that improves quickly. I hope attitudes improve quickly. I hope if this is going to be a county-ran airport, we're going to be county-friendly, customer-friendly to base pilots and not base pilots. But I will welcome a motion from – do I have a motion from council on
– Move for approval.
Thank you.
Second.
Is there anything from council?
What we voted on, I want to know.
Just the $500 rental fee for
– Oh, I thought we were talking about 9/11 there for a moment. But go ahead.
No, sir, this is to award a one-year contract to Light Aircraft of Charleston with four one-year contract renewals, and Light Aircraft of Charleston will be paying Berkeley County $500 monthly for this rental.
It's not 9/11, Mr. Davis. I don't think it's that funny, but I do think customer service is daggone important.
I agree.
I interject right here. We pride ourselves on customer service, and if you go online to, say, airnav.com, and you look up Mike Kilo Sierra, you will find that we do stand out customer service-wise. Now, I can't promise you that somebody hasn't had a singularly bad experience, and, you know, that's the one that squeaks the loudest, and I will address it, absolutely. But I can't do so if I don't know specifically what the issue is.
How long have you been in your capacity?
Sir?
How long you have served with
us? I've been at the airport 16 years, and I've been responsible for it as a manager for going on 9.
Wow.
So that it does fly all over me. I apologize. That's a blind side because we get nothing, to my knowledge, but compliments.
Okay.
I have an idea, but I'll stop there.
Well,
I mean, that's just there's always going to be someone, in my opinion. But we do strive to provide excellent customer service. That's what we do.
But Donald Trump wasn't in town, was he?
No, sir. We did have Warren Buffett come through after hours a few years back.
I have a motion and a second. All those in favor signify with aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Ayes have it. Number 3, library cleaning services contract. Who's that, you, Ms. Davis?
Yes, sir.
Move for approval.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor signify with aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Ayes have it.
Thank you.
I think we're holding 1608 again.
The order? Yes, please. Okay. Till next month.
I'll entertain a motion to adjourn.
Don't move.
Thank you.
All those in favor signify with aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Ayes have it. Thank you.
Steve leaving already? He didn't even stay an hour.
I would like to call the Facilities Infrastructure meeting to order. Ms. Clerk, has this meeting been properly noticed via for Information Act?
Yes, sir, it has.
First thing on agenda is approval minutes from the Facilities Infrastructure Committee meeting held April 11, 2016.
So moved.
Second.
Are there any corrections to these minutes? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, nay. The minutes stand approved. First thing on agenda is fleet management purchases.
What the heck is this?
Tommy New.
I get down to it, that is.
Ready?
It wouldn't give me nothing.
Fleet management?
What kind of reports can we get from you on a monthly basis of what y'all purchase?
Whatever reports that you would like.
It's a monthly report on vehicles being purchased, tires, accessories. That's that nature.
But excuse me?
Vehicles, accessories, anything that the
correct. And you, correct. You had asked for information and we provided it.
Right.
Right. Okay.
And I appreciate that. But do we have any updates?
From the information that
from the last time I got information from you, do we have any updates?
I don't think anything's changed. I mean, we have what we're budgeting for next year, but we're going to go over that in the budget presentation.
Do we have a four-wheel drive vehicle that the supervisor bought?
No, fleet management owns all the vehicles.
I saw Bill driving, he bought it.
Wow, I didn't buy it.
No, but seriously, do you have an update on that? Is there anything else we bought since then?
Yeah, that vehicle's been completed and it's been delivered.
I know it's been completed and delivered, but do you have an update for me, a piece of paper that tells me that you bought it?
Sure, we have an invoice.
That's all. Thank you.
Okay.
Next consideration is ordinance to prevent Berkeley County fire officials.
Move for approval.
Second.
We got a motion and a second. Any discussions? Hearing none. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, nay. Motion carries. I would entertain a motion.
Move
to
adjourn. For
adjournment.
Second.
All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
We are adjourned.
I'd like to call the Special Finance Committee meeting to order. Madam Clerk, has this meeting been properly noticed via the Affirmative Act?
Yes, sir, it has.
Thank you. First on the agenda is a consideration prior to first reading, number 1618, an ordinance providing appropriations for fiscal year beginning July 1st, 2016, ending June 30th, 2017, for Berkeley County to provide for levy of taxes on all taxable property in Berkeley County for all county purposes to provide for the expenditure of said taxes and other revenues coming into the county for the fiscal year.
Thank you, ma'am.
Mr. Chairman, you skipped the minutes, the approval of minutes.
Give the approval of minutes, Dennis.
Hold on this one. Let me back up and get that.
Just to go back up.
Let me back up 1 second. I guess that's approval Finance Committee on Special Committee meeting on April 11th. Approval for minutes for April 11th.
Move for approval.
Second.
Have a motion secondly and change these minutes. If none, the minutes presented are approved as presented.
Now moving forward to first agenda, 1618, Mr. Callahan.
Sure. This is the, we had tabled the first reading of the budget, and we've got two presentations, which is this item and the next item, which is the water and sanitation budget. I'll cover the general fund budget, and Johnette Colony will cover the water and sanitation side. You are each passed out. It's a draft copy of the budget. Now, why is it a draft copy of the budget? It's because there are certain things on there that we simply do not have the information yet to actually do the final copy of the budget. But it is the best of what we have. The two things that we are remaining needing is the completion of the redistribution and understanding the redistribution of the fire fees. I had a conversation with Mr. Gunn. The way that we were going to do them was not, or the way that we understood that the change that went through 2 weeks ago was not actually what the intent of council was. And so we're going through that on there. The reason it's not part of the fire budget is because the county has to distribute funds to individual fire departments, so it becomes a line item in the budget itself. The second issue has to do with multi-county park and fee in lieu money. That represents about 25% of our budget and of our general fund budget. And we those returns went in May 1st. And we will have a better idea this week where those returns are going to be. But I just wasn't comfortable saying that this is our final budget, knowing that 2 years ago that we got hit with an $800,000 shortfall because of the estimation on that.
So, Mr. Chairman, can I cut in? So really, we don't have the full picture.
You have a full picture with the exception of those two items.
Well, one of them item is 25%, right?
Well, that's if that's we made an estimation of what we thought it would be, and that's what's in there. But it's one of those numbers that can vary greatly. So it's one of those things that we best feel operating with a little bit more concrete data than our best guesstimate. But other than that, everything, I mean, we think it should be close, but we just don't know.
So we're just getting this early tonight for information source.
Exactly. So you can, 99% of the budget is in front of you.
And still
And so this way you get an extra 2 weeks to review it. You'll get a 2 weeks to know the meat and bones of the budget that the supervisor is going to recommend. And then we'll just do the second reading. We'll have the full ordinance at that time. Okay. But with that,
well, I'm gonna excuse myself from this first reading. I've been on county council some period of time, and I just don't think it's too helpful for first reading. I am gonna take this home and decipher what we have, and I'll be back on par when you have your second and your third reading when you know more. Okay, I just ain't got time for futile efforts when you don't have everything in front of you. So I'm gonna excuse myself, fine counsel, and please let me know before second reading. I'm gonna take this home and read it, okay?
You've got it, and you've got a copy of the presentation in your packet.
Thank you.
Okay, so just going back, because there was a couple of you who weren't at the retreat, where we are this budget year. Right now we are tracking basically, and this is the same numbers that you saw a couple weeks ago, tracking pretty much where we thought we would on revenues, but we're substantially lower on expenditures. And so while we had anticipated taking $2.6 million from the fund balance this year, we are actually going to contribute $1.6 million, as we're estimating right now, back if things keep on track for the fiscal year. These are the items, and these, and the reason we're bringing this up, these items you were going to see in the coming up soon, because they have to be accounted for. These are the items that we changed in the budget throughout the year and used fund balance to pay for. A good deal of them are recurring, so we had to absorb those costs into the budget this year. You'll see that in a future slide. Cypress Gardens, again, just want to bring up, we're looking like we're going to track without having to go into deficit. As of April 30th, actually, they just updated this. We are still 2 months to go. We still have slightly less than $200,000 to operate from. So where does that give us? And so we looked at this track before. This is where Berkeley County stands millage-wise compared to other counties. We are the lowest millage for county government. Now, I say that because we have to exclude the school district. We obviously don't control them. But when it comes to what we control, we're the lowest in the state at 50.5 mills. Matter of fact, we're substantially the lowest when you include in the fact that we have a local option sales tax credit where 80% of that's given back to the taxpayers. That gives us an effective millage rate of 34.5 mills. Horry County comes in second, but they're a close second at 50.8. Keep in mind, Horry County, for every mill they charge, they get $2 million. We get $730,000. Our budget's about $70 million. Their budget's about over $300. So they're dealing with a much larger tax base than we are. Charleston County comes in fourth. They are at 59.3, but a net millage, they're second at 42.7. We're still way lower than they are. And just so you know, Dorchester County is at 83.8. They're our neighbor, and they have no local option sales tax, so that's actually 83.8 is their net millage. And I deliberately did not include their county fire millage in that because that only applies to unincorporated. So we're number one, and our hope is that we stay number one. We'll address that in the next section, which is the fiscal year 2017 budget. And we went over this last year, and I referenced it in the previous slide. But one of the things you have to remember is while we're growing, we have to absorb some recurring expenses from previous fiscal years. And those are generally the ones that don't get fully funded because they take effect, let's say, halfway through the year. In a previous budget, and then we have to absorb the remainder of the year, or they were put in by an amendment of the budget, and it's a recurring expense. You all know all these. The standard overtime, we budgeted for 6 months. It started January of last year, so we've got to do an additional 6 months. The $2,000 per employee is about $500,000 it costs for implementing that for a full year. That was slated to be taken out of fund balance last year. COLA and merit increase, that took place in October, so we had to make up for 3 months of that, or 4 months of that. Then the restoration of position, additional SRO, we learned late about that, so we had to amend the budget for that. Board of Election stipend and detention center, these were contracts where the medical center was the big one, that's $320,000, and the food contract was the second one, that's $80,000 more. They canceled with 90 days notice, and then when we did their RFP, it ended up being substantially higher, in this case $400,000 a year, so we had to absorb that. Going to non-discretionary stuff, health insurance, as I've discussed in the retreat, it is one of our big issues that we've got to tackle, and we're not the only ones who has to tackle it, but it's going to hit us hard again this year. And keep in mind that we do health insurance on an annual basis, right? Calendar year basis. So this $900,000 that we're estimating our premiums to increase is for 6 months. We're trying to do what we can to take to rein these in, but the thing you got to remember now is we're self-funded. So we don't get to blame this boogeyman of an insurance company anymore. We're actually paying out what are the claims that our employees submit. So there's no intermediary that's taking money off the top in this case. That and just, you know, standard inflation on you know, on some items, operating expense items, although we did keep operating expense down. So what does this all add up to? About $2.7 million of new money that we've got to account for in this budget from previous obligations. So then the local government fund, you all know this, but there was some good news, and hopefully it lasts. And that is that the local government fund, if they were not to address it this year, we would have been shorted about $3.2 million off of the statutory formula. The Senate, in the budget that passed the Senate, increased the LGF, cutting that by a third. It was about an $84 million shortfall, and they added, I think it was $28 million to the budget, so it was about a third. What that means to Berkeley County alone is $1 million. If we can get through conference with that $1 million intact or somewhere close to it, we're going to be able to tackle some of these items that we're going to bring in the next slide. But just so, if we get that $1 million, it's still a $2.2 million shortfall that the state is not properly funding. And they're increasing our obligations this year, particularly with some items with regards to DSS, contributions to pension, that sort of thing, library, you name it. You know, we've got more obligations, and if they give us the extra $1 million, great. If they don't, then we're actually losing ground. So what did we include in this year's budget that's different from last year? Well, the big ticket item, this is the one we've discussed with you all and you all have discussed with us, and that is the pay study. Right now, they're reviewing the responses to the RFP. We think we've got some good quality companies in there to work from. So this is for the implementation. They estimate it could take about 6 months to do the actual review. So we're doing this for a half a year at a $1 million. So that would mean that the next year we'd have to cover the additional $1 million. But we think that should get us there. The next thing we're adding in there are our new employees. And we try to choose who we want, well, which departments really need them. There is, and if you talk to folks around here, they'll joke around, they'll tell you, I'd like to replace everybody with robots because they're not recurring expenses and their health care doesn't go up. But that being said, there are some places that we need to put new employees in because the county is growing. And there are some cases where we need employees in because we're actually leaving money on the table by not having the employees in there. Obviously, the first big one is the community action team. The sheriff asked for quite a few more employees than this, but this is what we can afford within the budget. And then we think there's a bottleneck. Our permitting times, if we were to speed them up, obviously you get those permitting dollars. Those fee dollars, and then you also get the properties on the books quicker. So we're adding an employee in permitting and planning to try and reduce that congestion. Mosquito abatement, they, particularly with what's going on with Zika virus and just generally how wet the weather's been, and the increased need for service because of all the new neighborhoods are going in there, they've asked for an additional body. And with the success that the sheriff's office has had with regards to arrest, creates a problem for the jail in that our attendance there goes up. And so therefore, we need to spin folks out quicker, and the solicitor and the public defender have asked for help in this matter. We're adding one position for each entity for an administrative position to provide that assistance. Beyond that, we're just gonna, this is something we can manage through cash management. We don't actually need any extra money, but just know that as we fill these positions, these open positions that we have for paramedics, We're going to be moving, continuing the move to 12-hour shifts for as many department, for many medic stations as we can get accomplished. So that is comes out to $1.9 million, again, in new revenue that we have to account for. So where do we get this, how do we make this balance is the question. So as we mentioned before, we've got $2.7 million in revenue in recurring expenses that we have to absorb this year. We then add the $1.9 million of those new positions and the salary study. We end up with a need for $4.6 million in recurring revenues. Well, we've had a strong year on revenues, but that will bring us $3.6 million in new revenues. And that's from everything from fees, from our estimation of multi-county park, and where we are on new tax revenues and growing the property tax base. We add that the $1 million that we hope to get out of conference that the Senate put into the budget, and we end up with $4.6 million. So we're balanced. Our new revenue, our new recurring expenditures balance what our new revenue sources are. So what that means for the taxpayer is that there's no recommended increase in millage. And we get to expand services that, you know, as best we can for the dollars and address some very long-term issues, as we mentioned earlier. Now, what happens if the House zeroes out the LGF increase? And I know it's always a risk when you try and do a budget and without knowing what the state is going to pass in a budget. And so we have to rely on what has passed in East House, not knowing what's going to come out of conference. Well, the supervisor recommends that we have to stick with the pay study. And the reason is that we can add all of these positions in the world. We can add 10, 15 more paramedics or road deputies. It's not going to make a difference if we can't fill the positions. And that's the problem that we're running with right now. Is we can't go to 12-hour shifts because we've got all these open paramedic positions that we can't fill. Sheriff's office will tell you he's got additional deputy positions that he can't fill. And we've got to keep competitive with where everyone else is. And these vacant positions, they may save us money, but they don't do us any favors because we're providing less service. So if the House does not zeroes out the LGF increase, then unfortunately, the thing that's gotta go on it is the 10 new positions. We're not gonna have a choice because we're not gonna have the revenues to match them. So it becomes incumbent upon us, and I know I'm certainly gonna call my representative on this and just say, you know, we're not asking you to fully fund the LGF this year, but we are asking you to concede with the Senate's version and provide one-third of the gap. Naturally, then we'll continue with the 24 to 12-hour shifts because that doesn't really have a budget effect. And so, you know, that's $1 million. Add that to the $2.7 million, that's the $3.7 million. We won't have that extra $1 million to work with. Here's what the numbers look like raw, and you can compare them to the previous years. One of them I'm about to go over in a second. That is the, you know, there's where we compare property taxes. You know, the interesting thing about property taxes, you think with all this growth, you'd start seeing, you know, really your largest source of new revenue would be property taxes, but it really isn't. It's multi-county park is probably where we're the strongest, which is the FELO as well. And permitting fees are the areas that we're seeing good growth on. So the budget in itself is 74 compared to 68. You might think that, well, that's more than 4.7. Well, the reason is because we are using fund balance, similar to have in the past, to seed one-time capital purchases. We're in the second year of our capital purchase or capital equipment program. In ones for the vehicles, that is a four-year cycle that it's going to take us to basically get into that. So we sell the vehicles after the fourth year. I will tell you that even though we haven't replaced much, the fact that we've been replacing more did allow us to actually contribute into the capital equipment fund about $280,000 this year from the sale of surplus equipment.
How much?
About $280,000. And as we go closer year after year, that number rises. You know, we don't have to dip into fund balance anymore to do capital expenditures because the amount that we get from surplusing these vehicles, while they have a reasonable amount of life on them, actually a good deal of life because they'll only be 4 years old, will fund a good chunk of our capital equipment needs. Expenditures, again, you can kind of see personnel, we're not going up that much. We've tried to keep the general operating expenses, and you'll see that operating expenses may go up a lot in the general, but down in elected, and that is because we shifted gasoline, printers, tires to the general fund and out of the elected's budget so we can maintain it in IT or mechanics. So, but when you add them together, I think it's about a 5.5% increase in operating expense. Keep in mind we had a 0% increase last year, but our average of the 10 years before that was 9.5%. So we're actually doing very well on keeping our capital expenditures down. And then going on to capital, we're going to continue on with what we started. We purchased somewhere around, was it 43, John? How many vehicles this year? I was thinking just the sheriffs. But yeah, about 82 new vehicles this year, countywide. This year, patrol vehicles, we're coming up with, we're going to replace 40 of them, or that's what we're budgeting. If they come in lower, like they did this year, we're going to end up replacing more. We have three replacement ambulances, and the interesting thing on that, if you notice, the price is down. And it's because two of those ambulances are remounts. That allows us to basically use the box and replace the chassis. Brings about a $35,000 savings per unit, and you will not know the difference between the units. So they're still going to look brand new when they arrive. Sheriff's Office has equipment upgrades as well. Chief Cochran had mentioned the fingerprint database and IT expenditure. I'm pretty sure we met every single one of their requests on capital equipment with IT or any other equipment, dive equipment, et cetera. County vehicles, it's about $950,000 would be the contribution to the county's fleet to replace existing vehicles in the county's fleet. Additions, and keep in mind, these are all replacements. Everything I just mentioned is replacement. So I like to bring up additions to the fleet separately. Since we are requesting funding for 5 additional officers, we're requesting 5 additional sheriff's vehicles. The litter control officers, those are just a line item in order to keep the fleet management program intact at water and sewer. We actually have to purchase them over here. So they were transferred to the sale. So we're purchasing them obviously at a discount to transfer them over to the county from water and sewer since that's an enterprise fund. Facilities and grounds gets one vehicle, and there's 2 additional to the EMS fleet, to the ambulance fleet. And the reason for that is when you move to 12-hour shifts, you've got peak time ambulances now that you've got to man. We're adding 2 additional ambulances to the fleet for that purpose. But other than that, heavy equipment, $850,000. We are continually looking to replace and upgrade that. We've gotten a tremendous amount of cooperation from Danny Thrower and Johnny Mitchum on choosing what needs to be replaced, what's not being used enough, what has high residual value. Miscellaneous small equipment, we'll provide you with a list via email on that as well. That is being funded from two sources. The first is that 20% of the local option sales tax that we retain funds our capital equipment fund. That's about $3.2 million, somewhere around there. And then $2.5 million we have allocated out of the fund balance for, because these are, in fact, one-time purchases and not recurring. And with that, that is where we are on the county budget part. Next up is Johnette, but that was a lot to absorb, so if you all have any questions on that, just fire away.
Mr. Chairman?
Really?
Mr. Callahan, on the salary increase, I'm going to try to ask an articulate question, but it may not be. You're predicting $1 million for the compensation study as a ballpark?
Correct.
What's the timeline implementation? Like, long range, is that more of like a $2 million probably increase, because we'll probably only get it done for half of the year anyway?
Exactly right.
Okay.
So we're doing $1 million this year, and then we'll have to absorb the other million next year.
Whatever it is.
Right. Or whatever it is.
And you know, you're not basing that necessarily on anything. You just know we're behind in several major areas. Is that fair?
Exactly. We tried to come up with an educated guess.
Okay. I'm not critical of that number. I'm just curious about next year's budget. And it might double. It may be more. All right. Fleet management replacement. We replace vehicles based solely on years as opposed to mileage?
No. I'm sorry. We replace vehicles based solely on condition at this point. Because I will have, and I'll give you a perfect example of what I mean by that, is that I think we have a vehicle in the sheriff's fleet that may have 300,000 miles on it, but we're retiring or deadlining vehicles with 200. And the reason is because that 300 just is a good vehicle. It just continues to ride where they might have some lemons with lower mileage that are just not worth the maintenance expense on them. So as of right now, John is basically taking a look at all of the vehicles with conversation from the people who actually use them and the maintenance garage to basically determine, you know, what is a maintenance headache for us that we have to get out of the fleet immediately. And that's where we come up with the deadline vehicle list. Now, in the future, it's going to be based on residual values. Once we kind of get rid of all the dead weight that we have in the fleet, we're gonna look at how we can kind of create a peak value for the sale. One of the reasons we went with the Tahoes, it's not the least expensive vehicle out there, but it is by far has the lowest total cost of ownership, and that's based on if you sell it at between 4 and 5 years of owning it, because you get such a high residual value for it because there's a secondary demand in the market for them. And I'll say the nice thing about the Tahoes, which unfortunately are no longer existing anymore, is we used to be able to buy them for less than 30. Whereas if you went to a dealer, the sticker price on them is 45. Now some of the items are different in these vehicles, but I think we all know that some folks just don't care. They want to buy the brand. They're willing to accept cloth front seats if they can get it at a slight discount. So we're going to be able to sell those at high value.
Let me say publicly thank you and Johnette, Jennifer, Marietta, all for your work in getting this here tonight. And I'm, of course, happy to support it through first reading. I do probably need some arm twisting and maybe more education on the fleet management program.
Okay.
And at one time, I understand the Tahoes, like you mentioned, were only marginally more than maybe the Explorers, but that price has jumped, no?
Yeah, that's why we're not in budget for any Tahoes next year.
Next year it's all Explorers or something else?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, that answers one concern, because I have some, it's a big number, that 1.7 million or I think, I can't remember, a couple million bucks for the fleet management, and I want to make sure we're using the resources. Do we have a comprehensive list? Does John have a comprehensive list of the fleet? I mean, I don't need it tonight. I'm just asking.
I can email it to you tomorrow.
I mean, we know we have 234 vehicles out there, something like that.
And yeah, and not only that, fleet management doesn't work unless you have a system to back it up. And so John has been diligently entering these in a software that you all approved recently, which is our asset, Enterprise Asset Management, or EAM software. It keeps track of everything, from who the driver is, from the mileage, when it's getting its program maintenance, what the maintenance was. Eventually, we'll be able to integrate live data in there, so that, you know, if a check engine light or some sort of code goes off it, we'll know. And that keeps the vehicles basically at peak condition so we can sell them at a high value.
And then we can track it and show the buyer, here's what we have on
exactly
maintenance
right.
schedule. All right, final question, I promise, is do we have a system of assigning vehicles? Some of the feedback I'm hearing from other jurisdictions is you assign one vehicle to whoever, employee
right.
A, and they keep that for the life of the vehicle. The theory is they take better condition of it instead of the higher-ranking person gets the newest vehicle and it floats downstream and changes hands, and, heck, I don't have to take care of it because I can blame the previous driver if this thing goes south. Do we have a system or policy? I'm not suggesting the right answer. I'm just curious.
Yeah, we do. And John does a very good job on the fleet, managing the fleet here. Matter of fact, we had vehicles assigned to departments that put like 400 miles on it a year. John took all those vehicles back, put them into a motor pool, and so people can simply check them out and they're not assigned and sitting in a parking lot waiting to be used. So in a lot of cases, the vehicles themselves are not assigned to anybody. They're assigned to departments, and if the departments don't use them, then they get taken away and put back into pool. And so we have a small list. Matter of fact, we're compiling it now of folks who are actually assigned take-home vehicles. That's one of the things that is actually in the policy that we have to, supervisor just has to provide that list to you all at the beginning of the fiscal year. I don't know if it ever has been done, but we're going to provide that list. With the exception of the sheriff's office, where all we're going to ask them is, I don't care who has the vehicles, just tell me how many of the vehicles are take home, because, you know, obviously we
more
don't want, for safety reasons, to tell you who's
I lied
where.
I do have one more question. Who makes the decision on the ambulances to go down to move? My understanding is we moved a gave brand new ambulance to Goose Creek and then gave Goose Creek's high mileage one to Hanahan. Who makes that call?
We leave that entirely up to EMS, right? Yeah, EMS makes those decisions. The Hanahan and the Goose Creek one are a little bit tricky because they got to get rebranded every time we switch them. Because they have Hanahan on it, or Goose Creek, rather than the county.
That'd make it more of a reason to give Hanahan the new one and just let them keep it for the life of it, though, wouldn't it?
True.
Will
but
you
then,
just look at that issue for me?
Yeah, I'll figure out how they're distributed. I just don't know the answer to it.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Chairman? One question, Mr. Callanan. What is our current fund balance, approximately?
We are at 16. Where are we? It's about 16 and change, and on a percentage-wise basis, that's between 28 and 29%.
Okay, we're in pretty good shape then.
Mm-hmm. Which okay. is why, and it just since you brought up fund balance, using the fund balance for one-time expenditures, we just recently went through bond reviews, and I explained what we were doing with the fund balance because they were actually concerned that it was building up. Their concern is that fund balance is just not used for recurring expenses. They understand that if you're using it for one-time expenditures like seating replacement programs, that they're fine with it. Actually, I forgot to mention those bond ratings were actually very good. They affirmed our ratings, but it was basically a straight A report card is the best way I could describe it.
Okay. Thank you. I support your request. No further questions.
Mr. Chairman. Tim, two questions.
Sure.
Will, in fleet management, will we have GPS units on all vehicles?
That's the goal. There are certain folks that we may not have complete control on, and there are certain ones that we don't want them on, because you can FOIA it. And so I'll give you a perfect example. I don't want a GPS unit on any of our economic development vehicles. because if I'm a competitor, want to know where everybody's going, or want to know what places they're looking, I'm just going to FOIA that every month.
Right.
So the goal is to get them in as many vehicles as possible. In condition, obviously, unmarked undercover vehicles ain't going to have them.
Correct.
Sheriffs, our goal is to get them in the street deputies, but we have to work out security issues with those, so that we don't have live access to, anybody doesn't have live access with except command staff,
right,
up to actual geolocation of the vehicles.
Second question. Is there anything in the budget for the Dorchester Children's Center?
We didn't put it in there. What we did for you guys to figure out what you wanted to do, we did put a line item in there, a organization code, if you wanted to find room. One of the things, if you can't find room, or obviously there's only, you can either cut expenditures, take it out of fund balance, or raise taxes, right? It's a revenue side on it. So we left it a placeholder in there for y'all to make up the determination, because you requested it.
Okay. No more questions.
Any other questions or comments? Entertain a motion to accept first reading.
Move for approval.
Second.
I have a motion and second. Any other discussion or questions? All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Let's see what's next on here. Bill number 16-19, an ordinance beginning the adoption of fiscal year 2016-2017, beginning July 1st, 2016, and ending June 30th, 2017, budgets for Berkeley County Water, Sanitation, Sewer and Water, and Solid Waste Fund, establishing operational debt service and capital improvement budgets for water and sewer, and solid waste divisions, and provide for the expenditures of revenues coming to Berkeley County Water, Sanitation, Sewer and Water, and Solid Waste Divisions during the fiscal year, and to amend the Code of Ordinances of Berkeley County with South Carolina setting
Move
rates.
For approval.
Second.
Have a motion, second. Discussions? Ms. Connolly, going to do a presentation.
Jeanette.
Ms. Jeanette.
Good evening.
You're up.
I'll try to take you quickly through the water and sanitation budget. We'll spend just a couple of minutes on current revenues in the current budget. Not much has changed since we met last time. I will just briefly draw your attention to the rate revenue. It's just a tad under. We're at 83.3% of the year, and we're just under where we should be on rate revenue, and I think that was just over-aggressive budgeting this current year. So you'll notice in the new budget, I've kind of kept the revenues a little flat in order to avoid that. We are going into our pretty busy or heavy months, I should say, for water uses in particular. And we did have a pretty strong sales month on water last month. So that gap may close a little, but I think we'll still come in on revenues fine. We are certainly not having any problem on impact fee and connection fee revenue. In fact, that's probably what will end up contributing the most to our overage at the end of the year. And as you know, our policy is with overages, we always put those in the R&R fund to help with projects. Anyway, so if we have revenues over expenditures, they always go in the R&R fund anyway. Next slide here is our expenditures for the current year. We're also underspending so far for the year. Some personnel, we've had vacancies like the county has, so that certainly creates some revenues there that are unused. And again, we'll end up going into the R&R fund. And here you'll just see the balance. We're still estimating at least a $2 million revenue over expenditure fiscal year end. And so that's what I anticipate, at least $2 million going into the R&R that wasn't planned, which is good, because the upcoming year is going to be a little tighter than that. Let's talk now about the new FY17 budget. For starters, we'll talk about water and sewer, and I will tell you that, like the county side, the budget is balanced. It was a little tougher this year. It does, like I said, keep the rate revenue pretty flat for water and sewer for the upcoming year. And we do not have a rate increase budgeted. at this time, anyway.
People happy?
On the expense side, some of the challenges that we faced were, we told you that last year that debt service is going to increase because of the water treatment plant expansion and the debt that we took on to manage that. So our debt service is going to increase almost $780,000 from last year to this year. So that was one thing we had to absorb on the water and sewer side. We also have an increase. Every year we basically have an increase in what it costs us to purchase water. But I wanted to show you that, I mean, this it adds up over the years, and we've been absorbing it because our growth has helped us to do that. But we're going to see about a $338,000 increase just in the cost to purchase water. We are experiencing higher water sales and higher water usage with the growth brings extra revenues, but it also brings extra expense at the same time. We do, on the water and sewer side of the fence, have $315,000 budgeted for pay study implementation. And also sludge disposal is going to be a little higher this year for sewer than it was last year because, number one, we had only planned for half of the year or so for last year. And also the rate for sludge disposal was lower. You remember we increased the rates for sludge disposal. So that's also going to hit the sewer fund since where sewer is paying solid waste to dispose of that sludge from the treatment plant into the landfill. So those alone were almost $2 million that we had to absorb. On the personnel expenses, we had 10 new positions requested in the water and sewer fund. And the expense for those, funding them at 85% of the year, is about $469,000, and that includes the benefits. We had two that were requested in the billing department, a utility billing specialist and a cutoff tech. And we're adding roughly anywhere from 1,100 to 1,300 accounts a year now. So it makes sense that these kind of things, we're going to start seeing them request at least every other year or every 2 years for additional help. We also had five requests in the water department for distribution techs. This is basically a crew that was requested for St. Stephen work primarily. Obviously, that won't be all they do, but they're primarily requested for to get started on the St. Stephen project, which is, you know, multi-year project. That's the request for those. And again, all these positions are at 85% of the year, so they're not even funded at 100%. And we had three requests for wastewater techs in the wastewater department. And those positions, the notes that I got from the wastewater department were, these positions would basically be checking air valves, air release valves, and manholes. And it was 247 air release valves and 146 manholes that they would routinely have to check, along with the ductile iron lines. So they're getting behind on schedule in that sort of routine maintenance that they need to do because they don't have enough help to do it. Also, the pay study, we talked about $285,000 for implementing the pay study there. No COLA or merit funding in there because of the pay study that's ongoing. We have 16 open positions that are funded at 75% of the year, and we've also included money for six-month probation increases and certifications, but mainly for the open and new positions, obviously, the six-month probation. And we do have a 10% increase budgeted for health insurance cost for 6 months out of the year. Talk a little bit about solid waste. The revenue side was easier to budget this year because they do have that revenue. They do have sewer supporting them with some of that revenue for treating the sludge that wasn't going on before. So that has helped them some. Also, they had some, we're expecting that rate increase for the solid waste commercial user fees to come on this year. That will be billed in the fall. We talked about that last year, that it would not be billed until this year. So that revenue is expected to come in, along with they've had some increases, a little bit of increase in C&D and in MSW as well. The only reduction to their revenue so far has been in the special waste, and that some of that had to do with the rate increase. Some decided to quit bringing us that waste, but But this waste is a lot like the fog we used to talk to you about, the fats, oils, and greases. It is a really nasty waste to take care of and to treat. So yes, you lose a little bit of revenue. We lost about 360,000 years ago from stopping treating the fog, but we also dropped on some of the overtime and some of the time spent having to treat that and clean up the treatment plant. On the expense side, they had some of the same challenges. Of course, pay study implementation, there's $135,000 there for the solid waste fund. And they had a $123,000 increase in the posi shell that's used in the landfill almost daily for daily cover. And then Solid Waste pays sewer to treat their leachate. So the offset there, you've got $1 million going in from sewer to solid waste, and then you got another $300,000 coming back to sewer. So there's about a $700,000 net difference there that solid waste makes over sewer. They also had some personnel requests. We had two new positions requested in solid waste. Again, funding at 85%. And one of them was a convenience center operator and one of them was a litter pickup. This also includes funding 7 open positions for the solid waste fund, no COLA or merit because of the pay study, and again, 10% on health insurance. On the R&R fund, I finished up some revenue estimates and a cash flow estimate on R&R today because this is my biggest concern going into this year, and it's my concern every year. You guys hear me talk about this every year, but it's getting a little critical, and we're going to have to plan how we're going to handle it in the future. But right now, our current balance in R&R as far as cash is about $32 million. And that's considering the $10 million that's getting ready to come out to pay debt service. So this is where we're probably going to start off at $32 million at the beginning of the year. The contribution that we're going to put into R&R is at just over $23 million for the upcoming year. And you see 16.2 of it is debt service. The rest of it, the 5.4, is coming from the impact fees that I've budgeted for FY17. And then another $1.5 million from operating revenue. Solid waste this time was able to contribute $1.2 million, which is good because they have some closure and post-closure projects coming up that are going to be in the ballpark of $8 million total in the next coming years. But I was only able to budget roughly $300,000 to come from water and sewer out of the operating funds to contribute to this R&R fund. So my concern is, even with the revenues going in and starting out with the balance where we are now, we're looking at $55 million in revenue. After we pay our debt service, and this, what you're seeing down here is $40.6 million just for projects. Volvo, and then the water, sewer, and solid waste projects, and then when you add another $16 million to that for the debt service that has to be paid, we are really going to be depleting this fund if we don't find a recurring and dependable revenue source. Right now, it's dependable that we're going to get some impact fees, but we can never depend on a set amount to properly fund this R&R fund. So this is my biggest concern, and this was the reason we talked about, or you've hearing me keep talking about, a rate increase that would solely be designated for this fund. We'll probably get fine through this year, but the later we find a way to start building this fund up, I'm worried that we're going to get, our goal was to always keep no less than $10 million in this fund so that it stayed. When you look at the long-term plan, that keeps it going based on X amount of dollars going in on top of that $10 million every year. So this is very much draft right now because I know some of these expenses we still have some bond funds left over, and I want to hash out what portion of that is bond funds and then see where we are. But I wanted just to give you a heads up that we've got to start thinking about if we're going to continue having this R&R fund, which has been a mass hit with our rating agencies. If we're going to continue it and really plan for it, we've got to start planning how we're going to fund it other than just impact fees, because growth won't last forever. It's good right now. We're still seeing strong impact fees, but it's not going to be there forever. And when it stops, we need to plan now while we still have this growth ongoing.
Johnny, can I ask you a question while we sure. on the R&R talking about rates, and Help me remember back in the past. I know we've done a number of rate studies in the past.
We did. We did a rate. Well, you know, we had the rate study in 2007 that was ongoing.
Right.
When I came here, we increased rates in 2008 based on that study. And then we just did the rate study year before last. The results that came back were, at a minimum, we needed to increase water rates at 10%.
Correct.
We didn't need to increase sewer rates, but the water was the big thing. In fact, it was much higher than that, but we worked with the rate with the agency that was doing the study, and at a minimum, we could get by with the 10%.
Yeah, because, you know, growth is great, but growth can break you also when you start talking about infrastructure.
Right.
At the cost of infrastructure and all this. And it just seems like I was trying to remember those rate studies, and that 10% sounds about right, the one back in
It was year before last,
okay.
Yeah. And, yeah, 10%, because then we talked about maybe just doing 5%. And then we even got down to where we did estimates at 2.5%. So we started out at 10%. And I'm just concerned that,
right.
You know, and that was before the Volvo announcement also,
right.
Too.
Correct. What was the final rate increase on that wave? Did we increase it any?
We didn't increase rates at all.
I didn't think. I thought we kind of backed off of it.
We did.
At that point.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay.
I think people.
Sure.
You aren't taking into consideration Volvo coming online, but.
Yes, this is the Volvo. The 14. There's $14 million in that R&R fund that will be spent for just for Volvo projects. Yes.
No, for Volvo projects, but I'm talking about when it is generating, you know, water consumption and sewer usage, and also what the attendant other.
I don't have any data for any of that yet. So, yeah, obviously that will help. Yeah. Thank you.
Well, I also have a question on the same thing. Is I noticed between year over year that the water connection fees for 2016 are substantially down from 2015. You're going up quite a bit in 2017. Is that because of the growth that you already know is going on?
It's because when the impact, it typically goes in a cycle when you have the impact fees being heavy one year, then the connections come on the next year. So that's why.
Mr. Chairman, you haven't factored in the impact of Repower South either.
No, sir.
When
not at this point.
When are they scheduled to go? I can't remember when.
I don't think they'll be online, even if anything happens. And Doug,
it won't
correct
be this.
Me.
It will not be this fiscal year. It'll probably be about 15 to 18 months.
Okay, so that is that's a pretty good hunk of change from them also. And one last question. We converted our pay system. I know it's not a lot of money, but do you have a ballpark figure on allowing customers to pay online, the convenience, what that has cost the county?
It actually, so far, you know, when I brought this up last year before we went online with it, and I talked about it at the retreat, we had estimated that the fees would be much higher than they have been. You know, the fees we estimated they were going to cost us between $20,000-$25,000 a month, and they're running less than $10,000 a month right now.
So that program is costing us approximately $120,000 a year.
Yes, but it's also what's happening is we're starting to see the shift. I looked at the day before yesterday, and we're starting to see the shift from people actually getting a paper bill to switching to the e-bill, which then reduces our printing costs.
Okay.
So that's what we had hoped to see, and we hope to see more of it. But I'm just starting to see in the last 2 months those numbers ramping up on the e-bill and the printed bills dropping down.
Okay, thank you.
Mr. Chairman.
Probably.
Two questions. And does it also, on that same point, increase cash flow?
I'm sorry.
Does it increase the timing of cash flow?
Yes.
Have you noticed a difference? Okay, and then on the 10%, you said study of rates increased that when you looked at others. Did that include private water utilities or private utilities?
I don't think so.
It was all public utilities?
I think that was public, yeah. Well, you know, our rate study was, and maybe I'm misunderstanding your question, but it basically did a study based on just water and sanitation.
Oh, it's just an internal study.
It's just an internal. This was
we didn't compare our rates to other
no,
rates.
No, this was our rates. This was taking our R&R expenses and looking at what we had in our CIP for the next 5 years. And it looked at, it takes your current expenditures and then applies inflation or certain factors to them to see what you're going to look like on your budget.
Oh, this is just looking,
this is,
okay.
Yes.
When you said rate studies, I thought we looked at other.
Oh, no, this was literally an internal study to look at our data. And basically, it's a strategic planning tool.
Gotcha.
And we do have this as a model that we can use. So it's not a one-time thing. It's a model that we can use ongoing.
Okay, thank you.
The last couple of slides here are just the numbers. Basically, everything we've discussed so far. You'll see that the revenue figure there is $59.8 million. It was $55.9 million last year. And you can see all of the revenue sources there. You know, I told you that the user fees, you can see an increase in the user fees there. And just a slight increase in the rate and service charges. And then you can see where the impact and connection fees are going to, I anticipate, go up from what we had this year based on the impact fees we've been selling this year. On the expenditure side, we're matching our revenue figure. And again, everything we've talked about, you can see the increase in other expenses. That's where some of the sludge cost is. So you'll see that jump a little bit there. Some maintenance and repair increases, and then the personnel increases. Personnel is a little bit misleading because last year the shared personnel expenses between the combined departments was actually in a sort of non-divisional account that first year. But this year I've got it more broken out, and it'll be more included. I know it's a little bit confusing, but. At this point, if I can answer any other questions or have any discussion, I'm happy to try to do that.
Any questions, Council?
Move for approval.
I think we already have a motion.
You have a motion?
Oh, you already have
one? Yeah, we had a motion and a second.
We already
right.
had one.
Yeah, motion and second already.
All right, okay. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Jeanette, thank you. Next is a consideration of a resolution identifying an economic development project only as Project Gateway.
Move for approval.
Second.
A motion, second. Any discussion? All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries.
Move to adjourn.
Second.
Got a motion, second. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed or adjourned?
I'd like to call the special county council meeting to order. Madam Clerk, has this meeting been properly noticed? Do you have freedom of information?
Yes, sir, it has.
Thank you so much. First on the agenda is report from the standing committee. First is Committee on Human Resources and Purchasing, Chairman Joshua S. Whitley, District Number 2.
Mr. Chairman, without objection and consultation with you and other council members, I move to hold this item until such time that a new scope and fee can be obtained. Just ask for unanimous consent, no objection.
All right, then we're going to skip over that. Okay. Next is first reading. Bills for first reading were not discussed or voted upon. The bills are read into the record by title only and thereafter sent to the proper committee for further considerations. Bill number 1618, an ordinance providing appropriations for a fiscal year beginning July 1, 2016 and ending June 30th, 2017 for Berkeley County. To provide for levy of taxes on all taxable property in Berkeley County for all county purposes, to provide for the expenditures of said taxes and other revenues coming into the county for the fiscal year. Bill number 1619, ordinance providing for the adoption of fiscal year 2016-2017, beginning July 1, 2016, ending June 30, 2017 budgets for Berkeley County Water and Sanitation Department, Water and Solid Waste Fund. Establishing operational debt service and capital improvement budgets for water and sewer and solid waste divisions, and to provide for the expenditures of revenues coming into Berkeley County Water
Sanitation, Sewer, and Water and Solid Waste Divisions during fiscal year, and to amend the Code of Ordinances of Berkeley County, South Carolina, setting rates, charges, and penalties for the water and sewer and solid waste service by Berkeley County Water and Sanitation. Next is a resolution identifying an economic development project known as Project Gateway, which is the project located and constructed in Berkeley County, South Carolina, and identifying certain economic development incentives Berkeley County would favorably consider to induce Project Gateway to locate an industrial project in Berkeley County, South Carolina. Do I have a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Do I have a motion and a second? Is there any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. Next is proclamation. Proclamation designating May 15, 2016 as Peace Officers Memorial
Move for approval.
Second.
I have a motion.
Second.
And a second. Is there a discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries.
Move to adjourn.
Second.
Do I have a motion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
We adjourn. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.